This is the story of Alliance Air Flight 9801. On the 20th of July 2011, a CRJ-700 was flying from Delhi to Kanpur, India. The plane was scheduled to leave Delhi at 5 a.m. UTC, and it was great weather for flying. They had visibility of about 5 miles with clear skies. By 5:15 a.m. UTC, the plane took off from Delhi, bound for Kanpur. This was a short flight, and by 6 a.m. UTC, they were nearing their destination. They got in touch with air traffic control to get an idea about the weather at the airport. It wasn't as good as Delhi's. It was cloudy and overcast. Thunderous showers drenched the runway, and visibility was at 2,000 meters or 6,500 feet. That was more than enough for the CRJ to land. But it didn't stay that way. At first, the visibility dropped to 1,500 meters or 5,000 feet. And then it dropped again to 800 meters or 2,600 feet, and it was raining. This wasn't good. The plane couldn't land when visibility was so low. ATC asked for their endurance. They wanted to know how long Flight 9801 had in the air. The captain let ATC know that they'd loiter around the airport for another 20 minutes, and if the weather did not clear up in that time, then they'd divert to Lucknow. But by 6:40 a.m. UTC, their luck changed. The weather was more or less the same, but the visibility started improving. They now had a visibility of about 1,200 meters or 4,000 feet. This was enough for them. The captain decided to carry out an ILS approach onto runway 27. The captain was warned about the runway. He was told that the runway had, quote, water patched on the runway, end quote. The rain had left puddles on the runway, but it shouldn't pose too much of a problem to the CRJ-700. As the plane started its approach, the pilots configured the plane for landing. The flaps were extended to 45 degrees, their maximum setting. The first officer made callouts at predefined altitudes above their minima, or the minimum altitude that they were allowed to descend to without sighting the runway. The plane was on glide, and all seemed to be going well. As the plane descended, it was jostled around by 5-knot winds from the left, but it kept descending. Then, right as they reached their decision altitude, the runway came into view. Runway 27 was right in front of them. The pilots took the plane lower and lower. It was just 50 feet above the runway, and the captain pulled back power to put the plane on the ground. But that didn't happen. The plane floated along the runway. Usually at this point in a landing, the plane gently touches down on the runway, but not Flight 9801. It had used up a significant portion of Kanpur's 9,000-foot runway. But the plane still wasn't down. The captain eventually put the plane down halfway down the runway. They braked as hard as possible, but there just wasn't enough runway for the plane to stop. The plane ended up overrunning the runway at about 50 miles per hour or 80 kilometers per hour, and its wings sliced through the antenna at the other end of the runway. But this airport was also used by the Indian Air Force, and they had intentionally padded the ends of the runway with soft soil to stop an airplane that overran the runway. So once they left the paved surface, the gear dug into the soil and brought the plane to a safe stop. It's nice to see safety features working in the way that they were intended to save the day. That's kind of fortunate, as there are a lot of buildings and roads beyond the runway. Even though this incident was relatively consequence-free, I mean, they didn't even have to evacuate the aircraft. There's a lot that we can learn from this to make flying safer all over the world. Once they had a chance to examine the plane, it all came back fine. The plane was well maintained. It didn't have any problems to speak of. It adhered to all airworthiness directives and service bulletins. In addition to that, they checked the weight of the plane. It weighed about 27 tons or 60,000 pounds on landing. They could easily calculate the landing distance that a CRJ would need when it weighed 27 tons. Even accounting for the wet runway, they'd be able to stop this plane in 5,000 feet of runway. So according to all available information, this plane should have been able to stop on the 9,000-foot runway. Talking to the air traffic controller, they got to know that the plane touched down halfway down the runway. That was definitely not normal. This meant that from the point of touchdown, the plane only had 4,500 feet of runway to stop. That wasn't enough. This was so unusual that the controller alerted emergency services before the plane even left the runway. But that still doesn't explain why the plane touched down so late. They got their answer from the flight data recorder. They found a difference between the airspeed and the ground speed. In simple terms, the airspeed is the speed of the plane relative to the wind or the air that it's flying through. The ground speed is the speed of the airplane relative to the ground. The data told them that their airspeed was 135 knots, but their ground speed was 146 knots, a difference of 11 knots. This was due to a tailwind. Tailwinds during landings are bad. The wind kind of pushes you along. Winds can add a ton of energy to a plane. Take, for example, British Airways Flight 112. The 747 made the London to New York trip in less than 5 hours and achieved speeds of up to 823 miles per hour. Why? They had a very strong tailwind. When you're cruising, that's great. The winds give you an additional boost and it gets you to very high speeds, and you don't have to burn any additional fuel. But when you're landing, the script gets flipped. During landings, you want to dissipate energy as fast as possible. A tailwind is just going to give you more energy in the form of ground speed, and that's why planes try to land into the wind. That way, you have more wind flowing over your wings, thereby giving you more lift. So when they flared for landing, the tailwind made the plane float along the runway. It didn't touch down where it was supposed to. The CRJ-700 was rated for tailwind components of up to 10 knots. So this just exceeded that limit. This neatly brings us to the recommendations made due to this accident. The first suggestion was to lower an airline's allowable crosswind or tailwind component to below the manufacturer's limit. In this case, the manufacturer's limit was 10 knots, so the airline would have to set their limit at, let's say, 7 knots. This would give them a margin of error in case the winds picked up during the flare, a sort of buffer to pick up the slack. In addition to that, pilots had to take a refresher course on landing on contaminated runways. It takes longer to stop on wet runways as the brakes aren't as effective. In addition to all of this, they wanted the go-around policy to be amended to make go-arounds non-punitive. If a pilot wanted to go around, she or he must be allowed to do so without facing any repercussions. The really interesting thing about this accident is that despite the plane going over the runway, other safety systems kicked in. Not all airports have overrun areas, and there are some airports that have overrun areas that have not been implemented correctly. And there have been cases where the overrun area just wasn't enough. This incident might seem insignificant, but if we apply the lessons we learned from this incident, we will be able to prevent something far more worse from happening in the future. This is one of those cases where the holes in the cheese just didn't line up, and the passengers on Flight 9801 are probably very grateful for that. Thank you for watching this episode of Mini Air Crash Investigation. If you like the videos that I make, do consider liking and subscribing. It will really help the channel grow. I will catch you guys next time. Stay safe.